So my paper is entitled "So Liberalism, Religious Freedom, and the Common Good." The subtitle is "The Totalitarian Logic of Self-Limitation." After Professor Crozzo had reminded us of the line from President Obama about addressing a question beyond his pay grade, I thought I was tempted to rewrite the subtitle. The alternative title could have been, I think it's a little too cynical, but it could have been, "What's the Pay Grade of a Dictator?" And I mean, that is cynical, but it actually gets at sort of the argument I'm going to be making here. Professor Crozzo said that he was not going to deal with philosophical questions because they're beyond his pay grade, and I thought if the questions are beyond the pay grade of a lawyer, I guarantee they're beyond the pay grade of any philosopher. But I think you could probably define a philosopher as someone who deals with questions beyond his pay grade. So, in that spirit, the paper is going to be it's a reflection, a metaphysical consideration of the relationship between religious freedom and the common good. So I'll be looking at just a sort of metaphysical principles, and these are basic principles in a certain sense, kind of simple, and that they'll. There are all sorts of qualifiers and implications that would have to be considered, which I don't do here. but it seems to me when we start working out and qualifying and raising those questions, we would have to keep in mind it seems to me the principles that I'll be arguing for here. The argument, just to make it sort of easy to follow, and I'm not going to be reading it. It ended up being way too long, so I'm just going to present the conceptual core of the argument. From a schema here. But the argument is going to turn on two Thomistic metaphysical principles that are really going the foundation of the argument. The first principle is that potency can be reduced to act only by something in a state of actuality. and the second principle, the second axiom, Thomistic axiom, is that a whole is related to its parts as act to potency. So they're both axioms concerning actuality and potency. And just so you can see where I'm going, the conclusion that I'm going to come to on the basis of those axioms is that a liberal conception of the common good, even in its most apparently Catholic-friendly interpretation, remains completely incompatible with a Catholic understanding of religious freedom. And this is a critical presentation. In the written paper, I sketched some principles of an alternative, but I won't be presenting that. But if someone wants to ask about that in the discussion. Okay, so what is liberalism? First of all, it seems that the essence of liberalism, I suggest, is a minimalist conception of the common good, and the minimalist interpretation. And the reason for that is that the common good is what defines the responsibility of the state and therefore the competency of the state. And it follows that the more expansive your notion of a common good, in a way, the greater scope the state has, and therefore, in a certain sense, a greater control over the lives of the citizens. So if the basic idea of liberalism is to provide a context for individual freedom, as much individual freedom as possible, that entails limiting the definition of what the common good is that the state is responsible for as far as possible. And I'm going to call this the self-limitation of the political good. Now, within liberalism, there's a spectrum of possibilities. Some will define the common good simply in terms of order, keeping the peace. There are other liberal thinkers that will argue for principles of justice, something a little more positive. And there are great differences there, but what they all have in common is the idea that once you figure out the minimal idea of what constitutes a common good, or once you figure out what has to be included in the common good, you want to still restrict that as far as possible, precisely in order to leave space open for the pursuit of higher goods in what is called the sphere of civil society, sort of outside beyond the state in the sphere of civil society. Now, in principle, the higher goods that you would be freed to pursue would include the good of religion, faith, and its public expression, and the things that would follow from it. That would be part of the good that you would pursue in civil society. The state would, insofar as that concerns the state would be responsible for protecting your right to that freedom. So religious liberty falls to the state as part of the common good, only insofar as it protects that right and possibly encourages it. There can even be a positive sense of encouraging religious practice, but what goes without saying is that the state is not responsible for the faith of the citizens. Now, I want to point out that what's implied in this is that faith is essentially an individual good. Faith is something that you possess most essentially as an individual, and also implies that religious freedom is something enjoyed primarily by the individual. And this is something that other speakers have talked about here. So the question then that faces us is whether a Catholic can live in this context. So in other words, is it possible to accept this particular liberal conception, minimalist conception of the common good, and does it free up enough space, you might say, in the sphere of civil society in order to pursue what a Catholic would mean by faith and, in fact, freedom? So in order to address that, the first thing we want to do is to ask, what does a Catholic mean by these things? And when I ask that, we want to start with what's the most complete, total sense of those terms. And what we'll do is when we see that, then we'll go back and say, okay, you know, sort of starting from the end, can we go back to the beginning? Is this something that would be allowed then by the terms that are set? so that's the way I'm going to proceed here. So what is freedom? In its fullest sense, religious freedom from a Catholic perspective is not, as we've heard 1,000 times, it's not, first of all, immunity from coercion, although, of course, it includes that. It's not, first of all, the power to choose a religion. It's not the ability to do what one wishes, including, for example, the exercise of one's faith. But in the fullest sense, what religious freedom means for a Catholic is adoption in Christ. The fullest meaning of freedom is membership. Dr. Healy mentioned Benedict's definition of freedom is full membership. It's belonging to a community. It's being a part of the body of Christ. That's what religious freedom means in its highest articulation from a Catholic perspective. When St. Paul said that Christ sets us free for freedom, he means freedom, obviously, in a more substantive sense, as an end, not just as a means. now, this understanding of freedom clearly includes choice, but it's not defined by choice. It includes choice, but it's not defined by it. Choice actually, in this case, then, means that by which one enters into freedom. It's the means by which an individual is taken up into the community to become a member. By choice, we enter into freedom. okay. Along similar lines, so then we ask, what is faith then, if this is how we're understanding freedom? Faith is not, in the first place, from a Catholic perspective, an object of an individual's act of will. It might include an internal, in fact, it necessarily includes the internal assent of an individual, an act of assent. But in the first place, it's not an individual good. In the first place, for Catholics, faith resides in the first place in the church. The church is the primary subject of faith for Catholics. And individuals possess faith insofar as they participate in the church, insofar as they are members in the body of Christ, which is the church. We're baptized into the faith when we're baptized into the church. And again, that includes, in a certain sense, the internal act of assent, but it's not defined by that. You can't belong without giving yourself, in some respect, in that. So that has to be there, but it's not what faith is. Faith is membership in the body of Christ. Now, it's very interesting if you think about that. Faith and freedom there, thus understood, coincide materially. They both designate belonging to the body of Christ, both of them. But the key point that I want to make is that there, for a Catholic in this highest sense, both faith and freedom are essentially social. And they're not individual goods, they're essentially social. They are essentially common goods, things that can't but be possessed in common, rather than merely individual goods. They're also individual goods, but only as being primarily common goods. Okay, now, having defined it, let's go back to the question. Does faith and freedom, as Catholics understand it, as common goods, can these be lived, can these be affirmed within the context of a liberal conception of the common good? Excuse me. In order to answer this question, we're not yet in a position to answer the question. In order to answer the question, we need to reflect a little bit further on the meaning of a common good. What is the nature of a common good in general? In classical thought, a common good, it's the prior reality of the common good, the a priority of a common good, the prior existence, the givenness of a common good that allows individuals to be joined together into a community. It's metaphysically impossible for a common good simply to result from individual agency, to result from the coming together of individual agents with private interests. The best that you can have is a coincidence of private goods, but you could never have a common good. The common good has to come first. And here we connect with the first axiom that I mentioned from Aquinas, who says that potency can be reduced to act only by something in a state of actuality. So what does this mean here? It means that the potency to achieve a good, the power to achieve a good, to be actualized in achieving the good, is possible only if the good is given already, only if the good exists as prior to the agency, only if the good exists as actual and not as a mere option, not as a mere possibility. In other words, this means that the actual state of the good, insofar as it's actual, that the actual state of the good provides the measure for choice. Individual choice can never exceed the givenness of the good as it is given. It follows that a specifically common good can be achieved through individual agency only if it's actual already precisely in a common way, as common, which is to say that a common good can be chosen only if that good already defines the community in which one exercises one's agency, only if it's a good to which the community is always already committed. If the good does not exist in this way, then there's nothing that an individual agent can do to bring it about. If it doesn't exist in this way, there's nothing that a group of individual agents can do to bring it about. It has to be given a priori. In this context, it's meaningless. It would be meaningless to talk about freedom to choose that common good. In case this is too abstract, just a very concrete example that occurred to me. You've often heard, in fact, I heard of all people, Ira Glass make this observation on This American Life, that it's only if you accept the indissolubility of marriage, it's taking that as given, that in fact enables the spouses to choose to stay together, to be able to stay together. It seems to me that in a certain sense, is a certain expression of a metaphysical truth that I'm trying to get at. Okay, what does this mean? This means that for Catholics, freedom and faith are possible as things to be chosen. They can be pursued by individuals only if they exist as common goods, as defining the community in which they're acting, only given the prior reality of the church. Now, in order to see how this inference, I think, really fundamentally challenges the basic idea of liberalism, we have to face an objection that arises at this point, which is, on the face of it, a very compelling objection. And the objection would go something like this. Okay, I concede that faith is a common good. It's something that has to be possessed in common, and that it has to be actualized already. But it can exist as a prior community in the sphere of civil society. Why not say that it exists in that sphere as an a priori good? So, in other words, the community precedes the individual's agency in the sphere of civil society, but not in the sphere of the strictly political good that defines the state's responsibility. That would seem to have the great benefit of removing religion from the competency of the state, which clearly, who wants the state to be the making all the fundamental decisions about religion? It seems to me that this, do you see the objection? So, or the counter proposal. So it would seem to satisfy the condition that I'm talking about without committing, changing the liberal sense of the state, so you could still say, in a way, the political good of order, peace, possibly justice, is simply a part, but not the whole human good, and still reserve space for life in the church as the whole human good. Now, it seems to me that this objection rests on an assumption that turns out to be problematic, and it also entails an implication that is something that liberalism forcibly rejects. And for those two reasons, the position can't be considered sound. Okay, so what is this? First, the assumption. The assumption in that objection is this, that the self-limited political good, as liberalism conceives it, is something that would be able to be integrated into a comprehensive human good as a part into a whole. And here we have, Fritz was talking about the Lego piece, right? The module, the limited political good as just a module that can be inserted into a larger whole. So that's an assumption. And I think that assumption is false, is problematic. Why? And here we come to the second, we'll talk about the second axiom of Aquinas. According to classical thought, there's a reciprocal relationship between a whole and its parts. They're clearly dependent on each other, but it's an asymmetrical relationship. The whole has a priority of the parts that the part don't have in relation to the whole. Why? A part can be intelligible as a part only with reference to a whole. And it requires a reference to a whole in order to be intelligible as a part, whereas a whole does not need to have a reference to the parts in order to be intelligible. So, for example, if I were to point to somebody and say, he's a member, nobody would know what I meant. That wouldn't be meaningful until I explained and indicated, made explicit the organization, right, to which he belongs. Whereas I can talk about a chess club intelligibly without having to enumerate all the members of the chess club. So there's a sense in which the whole has intelligibility, the part can be understood as a part only with reference to the whole. If you take away that reference to the whole, the partness of the part disappears. The part can no longer be understood as a part if it's no longer making reference to a whole. Instead, the part becomes a whole in itself. It becomes its own actuality, as it were. Now, according to Aquinas, two things, and this was a principle that Fritz also mentioned, two things can be united only insofar as one is act in relation to the potency of the other. Two actualities can't join into unity with each other. It follows from this that a whole relates to its parts as act to potency. The parts have to be potentials in relation to the actuality of the whole. Okay, where does this get us? Liberalism, by its very definition, refuses to make reference to a comprehensive human good, a comprehensive whole, in relation to which it would be a part. It refuses that, in relation to which the merely political good would be a part. Instead, it takes the political good as the only good that is established a priori. This is the only good that is given a priori, and all of the higher human goods are possibilities that can be pursued in relation to this a priori good. That means that the higher goods are potentialities, and the political good is the actuality, which means that we have an inversion of the part-whole relationship. Now, the political good has become the whole in relation to which these various higher human goods are actually merely parts. And it seems to me you find all over the place Catholic thinkers who have accepted the basic principles of liberalism who even if they don't accept the current condition, perhaps, of any state, but who have accepted the basic terms, they'll talk on the one hand about the political good being, you know, it's a thin conception. The political good of order is just the starting point, but not the end. It's a part, it's not the whole. It's only an aspect of the reality. And they'll say all of that. And then minutes later, they'll talk about the state as the framework within which the church operates, with these various institutions that would represent the higher good. So on the one hand, they're talking about the part in relation to the whole, but immediately they start talking about that as if it were the whole within which the church would be a part. You see this inversion. It seems to me, and of course, that's not a contradiction. That follows logically because of the a priori actuality of the part that I was just talking about. Now, it seems to me it makes sense here. We see the inadequacy of what is probably the classic Catholic response to the dangers of state dominance, and that is the principle of subsidiarity, which you're probably familiar with. And you appeal to this principle to try to limit the power of the state by increasing the power or the importance of intermediate entities and so forth. But the question is, intermediate between what? So the church is an intermediate community, an intermediate entity between the individual and the state, right? That implies that the state is the comprehensive whole within which the church is a part. And incidentally, I think the other pole, so properly speaking, I think that the principle of subsidiarity is indispensable, crucial, but it needs to be affirmed in the proper context. And it seems to me the proper context is to acknowledge the church as the comprehensive whole and the state as an intermediate community. And in fact, I think the other pole of the relationship ought to be the family rather than the individual, and that the individual in a certain sense would be an intermediate in between the family and the church, but that's a whole other paper. okay. Now, the heart of the problem, it seems to me, the heart of the problem here lies in the logic of the notion of self-limitation. And that notion of self-limitation is perhaps the most characteristic notion of Enlightenment thinking. You see it in, you know, modern science in relation to philosophy, you see it in reason in relation to faith, and you see it in politics in relation to reality. But liberalism was born in the Enlightenment, so it shares this. Now, what's the problem? A limit can be properly determined only from the other side of the limit, right? You have to be beyond the limit to know where it ought to be. A fish can't tell where the water stops and the air begins. It has to go beyond it in order to see where it's properly, where the line is properly drawn. What does this mean? It means that to insist on self-limitation, on limiting oneself on one's own terms, is to usurp the authority of the other in relation to whom you're drawing the line. You're sort of anticipating and trumping the authority of the other in relation to whom you're drawing the line. A limit, properly speaking, can only be received. A limit is an obediential reality. A limit, properly speaking, has to be received in relation to and response to a reality that's greater than itself. It can't be self-imposed. That's an act of will, you see. So let's compare two models of self-limitation. I prefer modesty or even better, humility. But two models, a modern one and an ancient one. So a modern model of modesty would be the positivistic positivism of modern science. Now, just very briefly, modern science claims that it does not make any theological or philosophical judgments. It claims not to do that. It claims to be incompetent. It sort of brackets those off. But in doing so, it effectively seals itself off from philosophy and theology. It seals itself from them, and it, in a certain sense, closes itself up within itself and resists being informed in any significant way by philosophy and theology. And in that sense, it can't possibly be integrated. It has to be open to be integrated. It can't be integrated, so instead it becomes absolute in itself. And modern science, as we all see every day, is constantly tempted to encroach. It's constantly encroaching on philosophy and theology. It's constantly giving reductive materialist explanations of whatever reality it addresses, whatever reality. But when it does so, and Dr. Hamby made this point very forcefully, when it does so, it's not betraying its modesty. This is actually a logical expression of self-limitation. It's a logical expression of it. Okay, the other model is the ancient one. Sophoclean humility, Sophocles, which is an image of wise ignorance. It's a very simple point. The one who does not know follows the one who does. The image of Tiresias, the blind, old blind prophet who is led by the child. The one without competence learns from, obediently accepts from, the one who has competence. Now, it seems to me that a Catholic sense of politics would affirm the second notion, follow the second model of modesty. The liberalism follows the first. And what does this mean? It means that in liberalism, the political limits itself with respect to the comprehensive human good, but for that very reason cannot help but constantly encroach on it and reduce that good to its own terms, to reinterpret it in relation to itself. Just like Kant sets limits to reason in order to make room for faith and then writes the book Religion Within the Limits of Reason Alone, liberalism does the same thing in the political order. It transforms every good that exists in it. I'm reminded of the joke from Stephen Wright, the comedian. I don't know if you know him. He's always one-liners, but one of his lines was, he talked about coming home to his apartment one night and finding that all of his furniture had been stolen and replaced with identical replicas. And my suggestion is that Catholics find themselves in this position in a liberal society. All of our faith has been stolen and replaced by an identical replica. It's been transformed. It's identical in every respect except one. It's not real. It's not actual as a common good. It's been handed back to us as an option. And it's no longer what it is, even though in some sense it looks exactly the same. Okay, so this leads to the implication that I mentioned, and this was an implication I hadn't anticipated in coming to and writing the paper, but it's where gotta follow logic. and that's this. If the state were in fact limited, if it were responsible only for a good it took to be nothing more than a part of a greater whole, it would have to recognize the authority of the body responsible for the integral good as such. In other words, to be genuinely liberal, the state would have to recognize the authority of the church, specifically with respect to the integral human good, and to any implications this good would have in the political order. Now, and I mean, that's disturbing. We're uneasy with that suggestion, but I find, it seems to me that that's, and we're uneasy because we inhabit a liberal ethos. We've grown up in it, it's in our bones. But to me, it's revealing that it makes us uneasy. The reason it's revealing is that it reveals that liberalism's claim not to be competent in religion is a lie, right? Why? Because is it possible to claim incompetence in an area without acknowledging the authority of the one who does have the competence in it? Now, it's not enough for the state to recognize the authority of the church with respect to the church's members as one religious body among others. Why? Because that turns then the various religions into various possibilities. It has to be, the state has to recognize the authority of the church over itself. The only way, and the only way for the state to avoid making itself a religious authority is officially, institutionally, to recognize the authority of religion. And indeed, of an actual religion, of the church. I say that as a Catholic. You can't but speak from your own tradition. And so that's part of it. But I think there's reasons why a Catholic church, but anyway, possibly in the discussion period. I'm almost done here. The state, of course, doesn't claim to be a religious authority. It does precisely the opposite, but I'm suggesting that this very self-limitation is what makes it kind of a totally inaccessible, incontrovertible authority. It's just this that usurps the church's authority. So it doesn't arise from abuse of power. It's not a corruption. It's not the conniving of individuals in positions of power. This simply follows from the logic of self-limitation. Self-limitation is inherently totalitarian. In short, religious freedom, as the Catholic understands it, is possible only if the faith is a living reality to which the political community is always already committed, which means only if the state understands itself as embedded within the greater reality of the church. In this sense, the minimalist conception of the common good established by liberalism, even in its apparently most Catholic-friendly interpretation, is incompatible with true religious freedom, quod erat demonstrandum. Thank you.